has love. Jesus has power. Jesus guards us through all this. Jesus is my Savior.
Jesus declares that he is the light of the world. Jesus helps us to see God, and he sees true on what he is true and the right. This means that we never have to talk in darkness. We can trust Jesus to lead by us, protect us, and we can be the light to those around us. When Jesus spoke again to people, he said, "I am the light of the world. Whoever follows me, he will never walk in darkness, but has the light of life."
Happy Sabbath, everyone. Today I'm going to be telling you about the story of Jesus. Jesus in his childhood lived in a little mountain village. He was the Son of God, and he might have had any place on earth or his home. He would have been an honor to any place, but he did not go to the homes of rich men or the places of kings. He chose to dwell among the poor in Nazareth. Jesus wants the poor to know that he understands their trials. He was born all that they had to bear. He can sympathize with them and help them. Of Jesus in his early years, the Bible says, the child grew and waxed strong in spirit, filled with wisdom and the grace of God was upon him. And Jesus increased in wisdom and stature and in favor with God and man. His mind was bright and active. He was of quick understanding and showed thoughtfulness and wisdom beyond his years. Yet his ways were simple and childlike, and he grew in mind and body as other children grew. But Jesus was not in all things like the other children. He always showed a sweet, unselfish spirit. His willing hands were always ready to serve others. He was patient and truthful. Firm as a rock in standing for the right, he never failed to be gentle and cautious toward all. In his home and wherever he might be, he was like a cheerful sunbeam. He was thoughtful and kind toward the aged and the poor, and he showed kindness even to the animals. He would care tenderly for a little wounded bird, and every little thing was happier when he was near. In the days of Christ, the Jews never gave much care to the education of their children. Their schools were connected with the synagogues or the places of worship, and the teachers were called rabbis, men who were supposed to be very learned. Jesus did not go to these schools, for they taught many things that were not true. Instead of God's word, they were saying of men were studied, and often these were contrary to that which God had taught through his prophets. God himself, by his Holy Spirit, instructed Mary how to bring up his son. Mary taught Jesus from the Holy Scriptures, and he learned to read and study for them for himself. Jesus also loved to study the wonderful things which God had made in the earth and in the sky. In this book of nature, he saw the trees and plants and animals and the sun and the stars. Day by day, he watched them and tried to learn lessons from them and understand the reason of things. Holy angels were with him and helped him to learn from these things about God. Thus, as he grew in height and strength, he also grew in knowledge and wisdom. Every child may gain knowledge as Jesus did. We should spend our time in learning only that which is true. Falsehood and fables will not do us no good. Only the truth is of any value, and this we may learn from God's word and from his works. As we study these things, the angels will help us to understand. We shall see the wisdom and goodness of our Heavenly Father. Our minds will be strengthened, our hearts will be made pure, and we shall be more like Christ. Every year, Joseph and Mary went up to Jerusalem and to feast of their Passover. When Jesus was 12, he took him with them. This was a pleasant journey. The people travelled on foot or rode on the oxen or the donkeys, and it took them 7 days to go. The distance from Nazareth to Jerusalem was about 70 miles. From all parts of the land, even from other countries, the people went to this feast, and from the same place usually travelled together in a large company. The feast was held near the close of March or the beginning of April. The feast was held, this was a springtime in Palestine, and the whole land was white with flowers and glad with the song of birds. As they traveled, parents told their children of the wonderful things that God had done for Israel in ages past, and often they sang together some of the beautiful Psalms of David. In the days of Christ, the people had grown cold and formal in their service of God. They thought more of their own pleasure and his goodness to them. But it was not with Jesus. He loved to think about God. As he came to the temple, he watched the priests in their work. He bowed with the worshippers, and they knelt to pray, and his voice joined in the songs of praise. Every morning and evening, a lamb was offered upon the altar. This was to represent the death of the Saviour. As the child Jesus looked upon the innocent victim, the Holy Spirit taught him its meaning. He knew by himself as the Lamb of God must die for the sinners' men. With such thoughts in his mind, Jesus wanted to be alone, so he did not stay with his parents in the temple. And when he started for home, he was not with them. In room connected with the temple, there was a school taught by the rabbis, and this place, after a while, the child Jesus came. He sat with the other youth at the feet of the great teachers and listened to their word. The Jews had many wrong ideas about the Messiah. Jesus knew this, but he asked questions about the prophets as written. The 53rd chapter of Isaiah speaks of the Savior's death, and read this chapter and it asked its meaning. The rabbis could give no answer. They began to question Jesus. They were astonished at his knowledge and of the scriptures. They saw he understood the Bible far better than they did. They saw that their teaching was wrong, but they were not willing to believe anything different. Yet Jesus was so modest and gentle that they were not angry with him. They wanted to keep him as a student and teach him to explain the Bible as they did. When Joseph and Mary left Jerusalem on their journey toward home, they did not notice that Jesus stayed behind. They thought that he was with some of their friends in the company. But on stopping to the camp for the night, they missed his helpful hand. They looked for him throughout the company, but in vain. Joseph and Mary were in great fear. They remembered how Herod had tried to kill Jesus in his infancy, and they were afraid for some evil had befallen him. With sorrowful hearts, they hastened back to Jerusalem, but it was not till the third day that they found him. Great was their joy at seeing him again, yet Mary thought that he was to blame for leaving them. She said, "Son, why hast thou dealt with us? Behold, thy father and I sought thee sorrowing. This is how you sought me?" Jesus answered, "Wist not that I must be with my father's business?" As he spoke these words, Jesus pointed upward on his face with a light at which they wondered. Jesus knew that he was the Son of God, and he had been doing the work for which his father had sent him into the world. Mary never forgot these words in the years that followed. She better understood that their wonderful meaning. Joseph and Mary loved Jesus, yet they had been careless in losing him. They had forgotten the very work which God had given them to do. By one day's neglect, they lost Jesus. In the same way today, many lose the Saviour from their company when we do not love to think about him or pray to him. When we speak idle, unkind, or evil words, we separate ourselves from Christ. Without him, we are lonely and sad. But if we really desire his company, he will always be with us. With all who seek his presence, the Saviour loves to stay. He will brighten the poorest home and gladden the lowliest heart. Though he knew that he was the Son of God, Jesus went home to Nazareth with Joseph and Mary. Until the 30 years of age, he was subject unto them. He who had been the commander of heaven was on earth, a loving and obedient son. The great things brought to his mind by the service of the temple were hidden in his heart. He waited until God's time to begin his appointed work. Jesus lived in his in the home of a peasant, a poor man. Faithfully and cheerfully, he did his part in helping to support the family. As soon as he was old enough, he learned a trade and worked in the carpenter's shop with Joseph. Jesus lived in the home in coarse dress of common labor. He passed through the streets of the little town, going and from his work. He did not use his divine power to make his life easier for himself. As Jesus worked in his childhood and youth, he grew strong in body and mind. He tried to use all his powers in such ways as to keep them in health, that he might do the best in work and every line. Whatever he did was done well. He wanted to be perfect, even in handling of tools. By example, he taught that we have to be industrious, that we should do our work carefully and well, and such work is honorable. All should find something to do that will be helpful to themselves and others. God gave us work as a blessing, and he is pleased with children who cheerfully take their own part in duties of household. Sharing the burdens of father and mother, such children will go out from the home to be a blessing to others. The youth who try to please God in all that they do, who do right because it is right, will be useful in the world. By being faithful in a humble place, they are fitting themselves for a high position.
Amen.
Happy Sabbath, everyone.
Happy
I am for once blessed to see the Church of Tomorrow taking up today's program, and I feel the rest of others also feel the same way. This week, Sister Elena texted me mentioning that this week we're going to have a kids and youth program. Would you like to sing? And I thought, like, maybe I should take that as a compliment. So here I am, and the song I'm going to sing is called The Least I Can Do. All that I ask for is a hope.
We have sinned, disobeyed, and become separated from God. We don't always understand God, and on our own power, we cannot be saved or come to the Father. But Jesus lived, died, and came back to life so that we could have a way to be with him. Jesus is one with the Father, and he is our guide, map, and key to eternal life. We can believe and trust in what he said, because he loves us and gave himself for us. He's preparing a place for us to be in heaven someday. Jesus answered, "I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me." Jesus is loving, helping us go through the hard way. Even when we are hurt, he heals us and helps us up and clears my troubling path and turns it into good. Jesus is my own boy. Thank you.
is the end of our program.